I've wanted to do this topic for quite a while. It's actually been on my list for probably 4 months, but I've just been adding little pieces as I go. Here a little, there a little. I just keep finding new evidences for this. I wanted to do a video about evidences proving there's a celestial dome above us. Of course, I've done videos in the past covering some things that are clearly showing that something ain't right. Now, the first proof I want to cover is how stars actually look when you look through a telescope or when you use a high-powered camera. Check out this footage here, okay? You're gonna see that these stars don't look like they're supposed to. And it's not just this guy's footage, okay? You can see it looks a little weird. You can see like there's like a dot in the center, and then like maybe some sort of like legs or spiral to the outer rim of whatever this is. And this is a star. And this isn't the only footage that's like this. I'm gonna show you other footage too. And actually, several stars look this way. And I'm trying to remember what type of camera he was using. He mentions it back here. I think he says it right here. Yeah, Nikon P610 60x optical zoom. He shows various stars and he basically writes down alleged facts according to what they teach us in school via the heliocentric model of how far away these stars are. What's so interesting is when you actually take out your own telescope, your own high-powered camera, all these NASA photos of stars, of planets, like, I mean, for example, Venus. There's actually a couple videos on Venus that are just very odd, okay? And actually, here's one of them right here, but there's another one where Venus is extremely detailed. I'm going to show you that in a second here, but you can see the same thing with all these stars. It's like a little dot in the center, an outer rim, and some sort of like maybe legs to a wheel. There's wind going on there. Let's see, here's another one. Same thing. It looks like an orange cut in half. That's basically what it looks like. It doesn't look like a star. It doesn't look like a sun that's really far away. Okay. Here's another one. Does that look like a star to you? Okay, so some people might think to themselves, this could be refraction through the atmosphere, but actually, I don't think so, because it wouldn't have an outer rim that's higher intensity of light than the center. It would be evenly distributed. It might, you know, flicker like this, but it would be evenly distributed. It wouldn't be a dot, a line on the outside, and then some oddities in the center. Okay, if it had to do with just diffusion and refraction of light and things of that nature through our atmosphere. Okay. You wouldn't have this very prominent outer rim and then a very prominent dot if it had to do with diffusion. It would be sort of probably evenly distributed colors in the whole circle. Okay. Now, if you look at this Venus footage here, this is a different one here. Actually, I'll show you this first real quick. We're gonna cover a lot of stuff. I just wanted to show this real quick. It looks kind of interesting, right? It looks like you can see through it even potentially, the way it looks. But actually, let me show you this. This one's far more detailed and is very interesting. Okay, this is Venus. Does that look like what you expect Venus to look like? Let's go look at a photo of Venus from NASA. Okay, whether we're talking Venus with an atmosphere or without an atmosphere, this is allegedly how it looks without an atmosphere. If you look at this, you can see a couple oddities. You can see first, a very prominent line around it. Then you see a dot again in the center, just like we saw with those stars. And in this case, you also see some sort of line in the center as well. It doesn't look anything like these photos. Okay, obviously you see this. It doesn't look anything like it. Neither does this one. You don't see any circular like this or any dot in the center like you see over here. And look, they're facing us. Isn't that odd too? You have this dot, this circle like this. It's almost as if it's facing us. Of course, that could be some sort of odd effect you might think in your mind. But the fact of the matter is, this doesn't actually look anything like the photos, alleged photos from NASA. Okay. Basically, I think they're lying and they're just making these photos up. Okay, because when you take out a telescope, this is what you see. You don't see anything remotely like what their photos are of Venus. And it actually looks a lot like those stars. It has a dot in the center, the same oddity. It has the dot and the rim. Why has it got a dot and rim? And it also has some sort of, you can see it's kind of got like some lines a little bit out. You can see kind of like lines or something. And it's like fluctuating. Actually, I think he even gets it bigger up here. Let's see. I think here? No. What was it? He got it really big. You can see something going on here. It's almost like it looks like it's alive. I mean, it looks like there's something going on there, you know? It looks almost like something electric going on there. I don't know if that's just an effect, through our atmosphere or what, but it's very interesting. It doesn't look anything like these. So, you know, I just thought I'd show those two things right off the bat. Then you got things like this. I'm just going through and just kind of going over some evidences. I'm not trying to make some spectacular footage here or something. I'm just trying to go through and point out evidences. I thought this is very interesting. impossible radio transmissions in 1915, where essentially the entire world could hear a transmission. That was before satellites, obviously. Okay. First transmission of the BBC Empire Service. It's broadcast on the 19th of December, 1932, from this building. And it shows here basically all the places it could hear. Okay? 1915, Arlington, Virginia. They're able to hear this message, this transmission, in Europe, Hawaii, which is basically impossible. Okay? Without satellites, allegedly. You know, allegedly without satellites. So it's kind of curious why they were able to do that. It kind of defies heliocentrism, considering that we're allegedly on a convex ball. There's no way for those radio transmissions going in a straight line to curve around the Earth, right? And even if you have the bounce effect that they allegedly, they don't even explain that right. Even if you take into consideration like AM radio and the bounce effect and all this type of stuff, and other types of frequencies that can bounce off the alleged ionosphere, which is another quandary right there. How does it bounce off this mysterious ionosphere? Why does everything bounce off this ionosphere? You know, the Kármán line, which where sprites are, that just seem to make some sort of halo effect when they hit it, like as if there's a barrier there. Why do radio transmissions bounce off it? Well, it's because it's a different atmosphere. It doesn't really make sense. Why does it actually look like there's something physically there from, you know, the ISS, the International Space Station, which I think is, a lot of people are like, well, the ISS don't exist. I actually think it does exist. I just think you can't live on it, okay? I think they actually put something up really high up like they did, about 260 miles up, and I don't think you can live on it. I think it's because it's impossible with the temperatures at that height. The radiation is extremely intense, and basically it's uninhabitable for humans. But I think they could actually have some equipment up there and something somehow up at that height, 260 miles. Maybe at one time they were able to sustain life for a short period of time, and maybe it failed quickly. I don't know. But the fact that they fake a lot of their footage from the alleged International Space Station, it makes me realize that obviously it must have failed. Now, a lot of people just think it's all VR, but I don't think so. If they were going to VR it, they wouldn't show some mysterious line at the Kármán line. I mean, you'd want to just make it look invisible as if there's nothing there, because that would, you know, basically be good apologetics for their, you know, there's nothing there. There's nothing at the Kármán line, even though everything bounces off it, and even though we have polarization of the sun through something, so that you only need one polarizer to make a rainbow when you can't do it in your house with a natural light in your house. It's kind of funny, actually. So there's like a lot of things that don't make sense. There obviously has to be something above us, some sort of dome, for there to be a rainbow with just one polarizer, raindrops. If you take raindrops and you take mist and spray it in your house with just a normal light in your house, like a light bulb, you won't get a rainbow unless you're looking through a mirror, because the mirror is the second polarizer. You have to have some sort of crystalline structures above us for there to be polarized light coming in. Okay. So I mean, all these things don't make sense. You wouldn't have radio transmissions in 1915 without satellites if we're on a convex ball. Okay. And I just covered the rainbows and halos and all that. Halos, you can see them often at nighttime. Just go look up at the moon, and you'll sometimes see a halo around it. What it is there's crystals high up in the atmosphere, frozen crystals. And it's not them alone that makes that halo effect. Okay, it takes two polarizers to make any type of rainbow or halo effect. And they just don't tell you that in school. They don't tell you that stuff, because then you'd be like, well, what's the other thing causing it, you know? And they don't want you to ask those type of questions. So then there's this, the Gegenschein. I guess that's a German word. This is very interesting. Okay, this debunks heliocentrism, or it causes some serious problems, whichever way you want to look at it, because they don't have an answer for this. It doesn't make any sense. This right here doesn't make any sense. Why does this make no sense? Okay, here's the question. How can you have a lunar eclipse in front of a Gegenschein when it lights up the sky when no moon is present? So if there's no moon present here, it lights up the sky as you see. But if there's a moon here, you'll have a lunar eclipse. How does it darken like this? How does it darken the moon, yet when the moon's not there, it actually lightens the sky? So it lightens the sky when the moon's not there, but when the moon's there, it darkens the sky, or darkens the moon at least. Doesn't make any sense. Literally makes zero sense with heliocentrism. The fact that the sky is lighted up says there's a light source there. And if we were in a heliocentric universe, you wouldn't have the moon being dark there, is the point. So they actually can't explain what that. There's actually a lot of stuff like this they can't explain. Another example is, you see, when there's solar eclipses, when there's lunar eclipses, heliocentrism doesn't make sense. The Ehlers effect. It's an anomalous behavior of pendulums and gravimeters, which happens during solar eclipses. Okay, it's first reported. An anomalous precession of the plane of oscillation of a pendulum for the solar eclipse June 30th, 1954 by Maurice Ehlers, a French polymath who went to win the Nobel Prize in Economics. He reported another observation of the effect during a solar eclipse in 1959, October 2nd, 1959. So basically, this focal pendulum allegedly follows the rotation of the Earth. In actuality, I think what happens is it actually follows the electromagnetic behavior of the Earth and the sky that's rotating above us. Okay, so in reality, I think this oscillation is a result of the heavens above us moving while the Earth is stationary. And when you have a lunar and solar eclipse, you have odd things happening because the electromagnetic behavior is tied into the sun and the moon. So when they somehow get in the way of each other, it actually causes things to go a little haywire. And that's what's happening with the pendulum, the Foucault pendulum, during a solar eclipse. It changes its direction. Whoa, that means the Earth's changing its rotation. All of a sudden it changes its rotation out of nowhere when there's a solar eclipse. Does that make sense to you? Do you think the Earth, if you imagine the Earth being a convex ball the size it is, and if you know anything about mass and velocity, mass times velocity, momentum, it's called the conservation of momentum. When you got a semi-truck coming at you while you're standing in the middle of the road, guess what's going to happen? Okay, even if it tries to stop, it has a hard time stopping because of conservation of momentum. If you can imagine the Earth being the size it is, the Earth is going to fall up into pieces if you somehow change the rotation on a dime. The Earth would fall apart. It would literally explode. I mean, if you have something rotating like it is, and all of a sudden you just somehow jarted out of its rotation, the Earth would not explode, but it would probably break into pieces, many pieces, if we were in this heliocentric universe as they claim. But for some reason, the Foucault pendulum changes its rotation during solar eclipses, which is impossible if it's allegedly based on the spin of the Earth. So I think it actually proves, or actually it proves that it's not true. That's just, there's a lot of anomalies like this. We got more. There's even eclipses that are impossible, where you can see them in a certain place that it's impossible to see them. I did that on another video. I don't want to get into that right here, but there is actually places where you'll see eclipses that are impossible. You're not supposed to be able to see them. What do we have here? Let's see. Picture of the dome. Okay, there was this one. I don't think this is actually true, but I got to show you anyways. There's some very old pictures, and allegedly one of these pictures is a picture of the dome from Antarctica. Let's see if we can find it. Yeah, it's in here. I just can't remember what photo. Oh, this is it. Here it is. Someone said it could actually be that the film was the type of film they used back in this time frame, in the 1920s. This is Antarctica in the 1920s. It could have been potentially a result of the film being exposed to the sheer cold of Antarctica. It might, the type of film they used back then, it might have done this, or it could be somehow potentially a picture. I don't know. I think I lean towards it being actually just a result of the film having a problem, but that's one right there, you know. And actually, in reality, a lot of things that we just commonly notice but we don't really think much about are actually huge proofs that there's something wrong with heliocentrism, like sun dogs. Okay? Sun dogs, rainbows, all these things don't make sense if there literally is nothing between us and the sun other than space. If there's just a sun, it's, what is it? I'm trying to remember how many millions of miles away it is. Yeah, that's what I thought. I was thinking 93 million miles. It's basically 93 million miles. I didn't want to say it until I wanted to make sure before I said it. Oh, here it is. Okay. So, you know, what I was trying to get at is the shape of sun dogs, the shape of rainbows. A full rainbow is actually a circle. That's another factor to all this. You know, when you create a rainbow in your house, again, like, you need two polarizers. You can't just spray a mist near your light and see a rainbow. You only can do that outside because of, there's a polarizer above us, which we're not aware of, and they don't teach you about it in school. Theoretically, there's a lot of things it could be. It could be something encapsulating the sun if the sun was small. I'm just thinking out loud. I'm just trying to explain it. There's something between us and the sunlight, whether it is some sort of dome above the Earth, and the Earth is not the shape they claim it is, or some sort of a crystalline structure just somehow between us and the sun, somehow surrounding the sun potentially. Somehow there's something between us and the sun. some sort of dome or crystalline structure. We know that much because we wouldn't have rainbows, we wouldn't have halos, we wouldn't have sprites, I mean not sprites, we wouldn't have glories, we wouldn't have sun dogs. Now there's another factor to this. The shape of halos, the shape of rainbows, the shape of sun dogs, it's all circular. Now, again, if you're making a rainbow in your house, and I'm going to show a little bit of the footage, I've showed it before. If you take just a little mirror, you put it in some water, you actually have two polarizers there. You have the water polarizer, you have the mirror polarizer. And if you shine like a light from your cell phone, for example, through the water, through the mirror, and put a piece of paper for it to land on, it will be a straight line. It won't be a circle. So what we're talking about there is if you're recreating it in your house, you have two flat planes. You have the water plane, you have the mirror plane. They're both flats, and you end up with a straight line rainbow. Okay, kind of makes sense, right? Flat plane, straight line rainbow. In this case, you have a circle. So what this indicates is whatever is above us has some sort of spherical nature to it. Okay? This is a fact. I mean, just the fact that it shows it in a circle means it has some sort of circular structure to whatever this crystalline surface is above us, whether you call it a dome or whatever. So, and again, you know, I can tell you what I think the Earth's shape is. I don't believe we live on a convex ball. I don't believe in flat Earth either. I don't think it's flat, but I do think that theoretically they could be correct in their map if they put it in 3D and make it a half sphere hollowed out. I'll try to show a picture of that in there. There's actually multiple things I think it could be. I'm not totally sure exactly. I lean towards hollow Earth slash concave Earth slash maybe flat Earth put into a bowl shape. Something like that. I think it's something like that. I don't think it's flat. I don't think it's a convex ball. I'm not totally sure what it is yet. I'm still trying to figure it out, but I'm gravitating more and more to kind of like a bowl shape type of thing. I am. I'm starting to gravitate towards that more than a concave Earth. I was thinking for a while it might be concave Earth, but I think there's something wrong with that model. I think it's partially incorrect. They don't have any answer for Antarctica is the problem. I don't think they have an answer for Antarctica. And there's a lot of figures that I've seen and things that don't seem to jive. The Antarctica isn't the mirror image of Arctica. The Arctic is completely different than the Antarctic. Okay, so there's something different there. But I don't think it's like the flat Earth makes it too extreme. And you know, they don't take into consideration some of the optical illusion effects that I've mentioned on video before. When you zoom in on like a ship that's out to sea, the ship will somehow reappear in front of your eyes while you're zooming in, which shows there's clearly some sort of optical illusion effect going on there when you're zooming in. I don't think it's just you're zooming in and you're somehow getting past, I don't think you're somehow getting past refraction or something. I don't think it's refraction causing it. I think there's refraction factors involved. But, you know, I was just watching a video by Rob Skiba, and he was talking about how when he zoomed in as far as he could, it looked like the ships were above the water floating. And that's an example of what I'm talking about. You know there's some sort of optical illusion with what you're seeing in front of you in the landscape. There's somehow, I think it's actually being flattened out. I think it's actually, we're in like a bowl. That's why when you go up higher and higher, it still stays at eye level. You're in some sort of bowl, or you're in some sort of hollow Earth where there's like a massive rim at Antarctica. I think somehow there's a rim at Antarctica, whether it's, you know, sort of like we're inside a ball-ish kind of thing and there's like a rim there, or if we're in a bowl and there's a rim there, I don't know. But as you rise up, it stays eye level. There's some sort of optical illusion with that. And when you zoom in, you see a ship that went over the horizon. That doesn't make sense if light doesn't bend. If light was straight, you wouldn't have that effect. So this is why I think sometimes, you know, Flat Earth has a problem with the map issue. Is because, and I know Rob Skiba has been trying to hit on that, And I think the answer really is just saying, look, man, why do you have to stick with the flat all the time? Maybe it's not flat. Maybe it's a bowl. Maybe we don't know what it is exactly. But we know it's not a convex ball spinning around the sun, because that doesn't make sense. And now here's another factor. I mean, if you take into consideration, the tides. You take into consideration the tides. Here's something they never tell you. Just go look this up. Okay, they tell you, oh, it's the moon causing the tides, right? That's what they tell you, right? They don't tell you it happens two times a day. It doesn't just happen when the moon's overhead. It happens when the sun's overhead. Okay? Why would it happen when the sun's overhead? The sun's 93 million miles away. It wouldn't cause it. You see what I'm getting at? See, why do you have a tide at two times a day when the moon is the only one that's close to us, allegedly? You see what I'm getting at? So there's something going on there too. And I don't think it's, I don't know if it has something to do with the electromagnetic nature, or if it's, I try to think on sort of a Tesla level, because I think Einstein was wrong on some things. I think he was right on some things. I think he's wrong on some things. I think Tesla had started figuring out some stuff, and that's why they don't like his works to be out in the public. And that's why he ended up dying penniless pretty much. And a lot of his works were basically thrown away, in a sense, and locked away in a key, with a key. You know, there's a lot of stuff we don't have of his. And I think he actually figured out a lot of things, and they don't want us to know those things. Okay? Maybe some real science that they don't want you to really know about. There's also a lot of very interesting information in the Book of Enoch that just does not jive with heliocentrism. Okay? And actually, it talks about sort of a deception in the end times about how people view the stars in the sky and what they think they are. It gives us the impression that basically people's minds are going to be blown when the end times happen, when things start falling that shouldn't fall. You know, oh, Chicken Little, you know. And that's another psyop right there. Chicken Little's a psyop to make you think only crazy people say the sky is falling. Why would they make that why would that concept be introduced into our society? You see what I'm saying? Why do they play off that? Why do they play off this concept, the sky is falling? Oh, you're an idiot if you think the sky is falling. They don't want you to go there. They don't want you to think that the sky could fall. You see what I mean? They want you to believe that these stars are millions and millions of light years away, or thousands of light years away. I don't even know what the closest one. What's the closest one? Let me go look real quick. Okay, so they say, obviously, the sun, they allege, is the closest star, 93 million miles, right? And then from there, 4.37 light years, which is quite a bit away. And you have 4.24 from there. So it's obviously extremely far away. But, you know, my point was is that if you've been lied to about all these things, and something starts really changing in the heavens, okay, like the sun starts changing its path, or the moon changes its path, or the stars start changing their path, you'd be like, what the heck is going on here? People are going to go crazy, because they're told all their life that heliocentrism is the truth. And that stuff, where did heliocentrism come from? A lot of people don't even know where that came from. The Emerald Tablets of Thoth. I did a video on this, Emerald Tablets of Thoth and the Bottomless Pit. Actually, Emerald Tablets of Thoth came from the Great Pyramid, which we still don't know how that was built. We can't build it today, the accuracy that it has. I did a couple videos on that. But the Emerald Tablets of Thoth were found at the top of the Great Pyramid, and some think that the Great Pyramid was actually a means for the fallen ones to retain their knowledge through the Flood. Okay? So what we're talking about is sort of their library of evil knowledge was kept up there, and the Emerald Tablets of Thoth was one of them. And it was written in Paleo-Hebrew, or Phoenician as they call it, which is basically, from what I understand, the original language, the language of heaven. And what it says, it says a lot of stuff in it. It's kind of crazy. It talks about a bottomless pit being underneath the Great Pyramid. It talks about the sun and how that everything revolves around the sun. So it was actually about sun worship. And Copernicus, Galileo, were both sun worshipers. They were called Hermes, okay, the false god of knowledge, Hermes. Hermes is the same false god as the god Thoth. Thoth and Hermes are the same god, false god. And Thoth is where we get the term thought from. Hermeneutics, biblical hermeneutics, we get that term from Hermes, which means knowledge, biblical hermeneutics. It's kind of an irony, right? So, these Emerald Tablets of Thoth are where Copernicus and Galileo got their concept of our solar system. And that's what we've been taught all this time. Okay? From a fallen angel called Thoth, or Hermes. That's where we got this knowledge from. And could it be such a great deception that it would be used in these end times to lead people to believe lies and to believe there's no God and that evolution is what happened? Yeah, that's what happened. That's what we're seeing here. Okay? It's a deception to keep people in the dark so they don't know what's really going on. NASA, even the term NASA is a Hebrew term that means to deceive.
I found this very curious, that the term NASA in Hebrew means to take up, bring up, but also in a negative connotation it means to lead astray, mentally delude, morally seduce, beguile, deceive greatly. Which kind of explains the whole NASA program if you think about it. Hidden in plain sight.
And that's what NASA does, is they deceive people. They make people believe that heliocentrism has already been proven. They have all their alleged evidences that they give us, the moon landings, just everything. And there's so much irony to all this. Even Skiba's covered some of this with the Richard Byrd. Okay, if you just follow the succession of events, okay. So here we have Richard E. Byrd and his Antarctic expeditions, which he did numerous of. And then he had sort of some very odd entries in his journals. That don't make a lot of sense if Antarctica is what they claim it is. And what was so interesting is after all these, we have all of a sudden Operation Fishbowl, and actually there's a few things before Operation Fishbowl where it's like they were trying to do nuclear testing up high in the atmosphere, really high up, basically at the Kármán line, where I basically think there is some sort of crystalline structure. They're doing all these nuclear tests like they're basically trying to blow the dome or whatever's above us. Did they find something in Antarctica which led them to think, hey, shoot, what the heck's going on here? We got to do something up with this, whatever's above us in the atmosphere. And then here comes the PSYOP. You know, they say that we're going to go to the moon, right? We had Kennedy say we're going to go to the moon. Next thing you know, we're on the moon. All out of nowhere. And now we have the Orion missions, which we're still trying to figure out how to get through the Van Allen belt, which we already got through in a tin can way back when, and then moon landings. You know, you remember that PSYOP, right? Where they had the real footage was accidentally lost, and they, all they have is the grainy footage left, and where they took the photo of Earth through a small little window in the Apollo 17 module. And they just happened to accidentally release some footage that showed that they faked the circle of the Earth, the round ball of the Earth. So, I mean, there's way too much PSYOP going on here. And then you have the fact that right before Operation Fishbowls, when they imported all these freaking Nazi scientists, and half of these Nazi scientists were doing psychological tests and MK-Ultra type operation stuff. Basically, stuff on how to deceive the public. They were into that kind of thing as well. Half of these scientists were like that. And a lot of these scientists who were war criminals ended up in NASA. Okay? And some of the scientists before that were under Hitler were talking about how we were in some sort of concave surface. You even have some, there's even some American military photos that show them using some extremely high-powered telescope looking upward and seeing a New York skyline that seemed to go up in the background. And this is what I was talking about. The higher the magnification you can get, the clearer of a day, the more you can see farther back. And I think it just keeps going up and up and up. I think it's actually we're in a sort of a bowl shape or something. Now, these evidences are used for concave Earth, but you know the thing that doesn't make sense is they can't explain the Richard Byrd, Antarctic oddities. They can't explain the whole Nazi oddities with Antarctica, the treaty, so we can't go there anymore. There's way too many things that just point to there being something different about Antarctica, and the distances change in the southern part of the hemisphere. So it makes me think it's not concave Earth as usually commonly shown. I think it could be more so along the lines of a bowl shape, sort of like flat Earth put in a bowl shape. That's kind of what I'm thinking it is. Maybe not. I don't know exactly what exactly it would be. Maybe it's a half sphere hollowed out. That would actually make a lot of sense to me. And that actually would make sense with the UN flag map. That would also solve a lot of the problems with the flight pass. And it actually makes sense with the azimuth map. Rob Skiba was trying to point out the fact that, you know, the farther out you go, it gets larger and larger, but it's actually the same distances. And I think the solution to that is it putting it into a 3D bowl shape. That's what it is. And I think all this stuff adds up to that. If you look into all these evidences, it points you that direction. So I think that's what it really is. I'm leaning towards that. I don't know if that's what it is, though, of course. But I'm going off all the little pieces of evidence everywhere, and that's where it leads me. It leads me to us being in a freaking bowl. A fishbowl. Okay? Isn't that so funny? They call it Operation Fishbowl. They're trying to blow away the dome above us. What if we're literally in, like, a bowl and with a top dome like this? That's kind of what I'm wondering. I don't know exactly what the shape is. This is just thinking out loud. I mean, it could be 100 different shapes. I mean, you could have a completely different shaped dome. It could be different than this. It could be, I don't know. There's a lot of different ways you can make it, but I think that's basically where it's going. I don't think flat Earth is correct. I don't think concave Earth is correct either. Although, you know, I think concave Earth has some really good evidences. I think if you put the two together, it makes a hybrid theory that actually might fit everything. It might fit all the data completely and make sense of the whole thing. And it still you can retain all the things, all the evidences fit up with this. If you hybrid the two theories together, all the evidences can fit up with this, is what I'm trying to say. You don't have any really difficult things to try to figure out. And I think the flight paths of the sun and the moon are probably sort of a Fibonacci sequence. I really do. And I've seen a couple videos covering this. I think it's some sort of Fibonacci sequence is what they follow, the sun and the moon, as they go around in the Earth. And I think even the star paths and the constellations make more sense with some sort of concave Earth idea or a bowl shape idea than the flat Earth idea. So I think if you have a bowl shape and you have some sort of dome above us, whether it's an inverted dome, which goes with the concavity of Earth, which is one way I'm thinking it might be, or it could be like this, or it could be like a combination of both. I don't know. But I do actually think it's probably follows the same contour, and that might be why it shows a circle. And maybe there's more than one dome above us. I'm thinking that as well. I haven't figured out all the rotation paths. I haven't made it some model up, although I could do it because I actually have engineering background in computer-aided engineering design. I've used several different CAD, even 3D. I've used a lot of 3D CADs. Not just something like AutoCAD, but I've used like Unigraphics. I've used Ideas. I've used Pro-E. All those three are actually engineering applications used to draw things in 3D. But so I might actually do it. I've used Mavre and Pavre as well, which are free ones. So I might actually make my own model eventually and then try to figure this all out. It's a lot of work though, you know what I mean? But this is kind of where I'm leaning with the whole thing. And it kind of gets all the evidences and fits them all together. Anyway, hopefully, you know, like I said, I'm not saying, you know, one side's wrong or one side's right. I think, you know, each side has its weaknesses, it has its strengths, and they have to really sit down and figure out what it is. You don't want to just try to stick with what you think it is and, like, force it to be a certain way. You don't want to have to force it, because this is a scientific study. You know, you use a scientific method, you have to consider all options. You have to put all options on the table. You can't just say, oh, it has to be flat, or it has to be a concave earth ball or something, or it has to be a convex ball, because there's even geocentric convex earth ball shape as well, although I think that one doesn't work. But I mean, that's better than the heliocentric model. So at any rate, thanks for watching. Caught in the crossfire. It's caught in the crossfire.